I think the tokens are the big unknown of the Greek archaeology, or perhaps even of the international archaeology, the big unknown. So I'm going to talk to you tonight about tokens in late classical and Hellenistic Athens. This has been a project that has started as a part of the big ERC project, Token Communities in the Ancient Mediterranean. And afterwards, I continued independently as a Mairi Curie Research Fellow. So this is also the two books mentioned by Rebecca are the output of my fellowship. The structure, a little bit about the structure of tonight's talk. First, we will try to approach tokens by giving a definition of the Greek term. The Greek term is symbolon. The beginnings are not in Athens, but lay in Mesopotamia, ex oriente lux. But Athenians came to know tokens possibly through other civilizations of the Mediterranean area. Then I think that there are two key passages in the ancient literature. One is in Herodot and the other is in Aristophanes. So we will come to know these two passages nearer. Then it will be time to revisit the definition, to revise the original definition that I will give you. My focus will lay obviously in classical Athens. And there I will try to give responses to the questions, why the Athenians? Why did the Athenians use tokens? To give a series of responses to this question. It is about governance. It has to do also with the military. And also the big question, were tokens in Athens private or public, or were they both? And what about distributions? Because inevitably, every ancient historian, when thinking about tokens, will think of, when discussing on tokens, we think about the distributions, grain distributions in the Roman Empire, but it all began much earlier than the Roman Empire. When looking in the catalog of the Athenian agora excavations, then immediately there will come up approximately 1,000 of entries on tokens. 1,000 of entries on tokens, lead tokens, mostly lead tokens. Approximately 1,000 of lead tokens have been excavated in the Athenian Agora. And there are also approximately 2,000 more kept in museums and European collections. Clay tokens and bronze tokens are fewer, are preserved in fewer numbers. The Greek word for token is symbolon. It comes from the verb symvalon, which means to bring closer together. Symbolon therefore means something, part of a whole that acquires its full significance when the two parts come together. Plato, in his Symposium, writes, each of us is a tally of a human being, having been sliced like flat fish, two from one. And each person is always searching for the tally that belongs to them. There is a pluralism when looking to the other, now I make a leap to the modern world, when looking to the other modern, nowadays, the modern languages, European languages, there is a plurality in concerning the term. The Latins, the Romans used tessere, which comes from the word that means something that has four sides. But there is also much more complexity in the modern languages, zeton in French, zeton in Italian, marche in German. And also there's a lot of composed words. Let's say, for example, there is Handelsmarke, Briefmarke. That means, that implies in background that there were a variety, there was a variety of uses and functions for the object of the tokens. Tokens first began in Mesopotamia. And very important is the research done by Denise Schmant-Bessera. In the early Neolithicum, Denise Schmant-Bessera identified 12 different shapes made of clay. Each of these shapes symbolized or stood for a different measure of grain. Tokens in Neolithic Mesopotamia were a means of accounting and means of administrating the agricultural surplus. Of course, Denis Simandes-Serra goes on to say that with tokens, because by impressing tokens on an envelope made of clay, this was the first beginning of the Cunei script. So with tokens brought about accounting, arithmetic, mathematics, and writing. Returning to the Greek-speaking world of the Archaic and the Classical period, Athens is not exclusive with tokens. Approximately 60 years ago, there was an excavation in North Epirus, brought to light tokens from a city, from the city Antigonea. The interpretation given by the excavators was that these were tokens for the assembly. These tokens, they are inscribed with the ethnikon of the city. In the ancient theater of Pherae, we have all the specimens that I showed to you, they are made of lead. So from Pherae, from the Thessalian city of Pherae, we have another example found in the theater. And recently, in the gymnasium of Eretria, three lead tokens, lettered tokens. This brings us closer to the conditions in Athens, closer to the examples that I will show you from Athens. They are published by the excavators in a poster for a conference, and they have uploaded on Academia. I would have a great deficit if I wouldn't talk to you about the inscription, the famous inscription published by Gautier from Iasos in Asia Minor. And Gautier published brilliantly this whole inscription. There we have tokens for the assembly, tokens for participation in the assembly, an early Hellenistic inscription in the corpus of Iasos, it's number 20. The Athenians, these are all late examples that I have shown to you, but the Athenians were probably aware of the tessere hospitalis, and numerous examples are known from the western part of the ancient Mediterranean. And this is an example inscribed in Etruscan, found in Rome, and it bears an Etruscan name. In this connection, there is a valuable passage from Euripides' Medea. Medea is angry and her husband tries to appease her anger. So he promises, among other things, that I will give you tokens. And with these tokens, you will go to my friends from hospitality, and they will treat you well. The ancient collection of all these ancient sources on Athenian tokens, you may find very useful in Philippe Gautier's book 1972, Symbola. Gautier, the book, I have to say that the Gautier's book does not discuss the tokens, but discusses the another category of monuments, the commercial agreements between cities, which are also known under the name symbola. Recently, we had an overview, but it was an overview published about the Tessera Hospitalis. I think this is extremely useful in terms of what we see. What we see here, all these tokens have something in common, all these Tessera Hospitalis. They are split tokens. They are tokens cut in two. In Euripides' Medea, the ancient scholion to this line, to this verse, reads that tokens could be any object that was cut in two. Cut into and described and shared among host and its guest. And it's interesting to find corroboration, not readily in the Greek speaking world, but these objects are encountered in the western part of the Mediterranean and many of them in the Celtiberian area and inscribed in Celtiberian. The literary sources there are not so many. The ancient Greek literary sources on the tokens are not so many. The first point has a short collection of these. And then it's, I think, Herodotus, this is quite important. It's the story of the Spartan Glaucus and the Milesian. I can tell you in brief what it's all about. It is about a Milesian who was rich, and he had some money, and he had heard about the Spartan Glaucus, that he was very just. So he came to Sparta and he entrusted his money to Glaucus. He said, accept the money for me and take and keep these tokens. And please give this money to whoever presents you with the tokens. The story goes on to say that the sons of the man came after years, and they came to Sparta. They spoke to Glaucus, showed him the tokens, and demanding the money back. There's also another story, excuse me for the typo, it's in Aristophanes' Birds. It's about, this is annoying, so I must find a way to, but it's not possible, so never mind. It's Iris has sneaked through the defenses, the goddess Iris has sneaked through the defenses, and she's brought under guard to face Pisthetero's interrogation. So Pisthetero asks him, he's furious, so he asks her various questions. Have you a permit bearing the seal of the storks? Because this is the city of the birds. Iris seems not to understand what's going on. Pisthetero is pressing her. Did you get one? Are you mad? No head bird, no officer of the birds has placed a token upon your token. A token to me, you poor fool. This is in the Lord Classical Library. This is translated as safe conduct. But it's pretty clear the ancient text reads symbol. And the verb is epevale, has placed upon. A token is placed upon your token. And if we take a look on this example that I have, this is only one part of a split token. We have a part of an animal, a half part of an animal, that would be placed to another half part of an animal, forming a perfect whole. So where are we? We are in the middle of the Peloponnesian War, because this was presented in the year 414 BC, and the atmosphere is military atmosphere, and tokens play an important role for recognizing, for authenticating the person coming in, the person coming in the besieged city or coming through the defenses. In the other story, in the story that I told you previously, the tokens given is a pledge. Is a pledge is a recognition it's an acknowledgement of a pledge that the money must be returned because we show you the tokens. We are the ones who we are entitled for the money, the sons of the Milesian say to Glaucus. So a functionalist approach to symbola would be that they are objects, first of all, they are a code. They have a message. They have a message that can be decoded by the two parts who had concluded the agreement. It is a kind of agreement. The Milesian on one hand, Glaucus on the other. And the military symbola, obviously, they are issued by the heads of the military. And we have also two parties, the one who brings the symbola, and this must be checked by the guards at the gates of the city. This comparison. Then this is a sign of identification. So I see these two or three main functions for symbola. It's a code, it's an acknowledgement of implications and sign of identification, a new definition. This is a new definition for a symbola. Why did the Athenians use tokens? Athenians have been signaled by Margaret Crosby, who published the first and the most comprehensive up-to-date catalog on Athenian tokens, excavating the Athenian Agora. Crosby says that the Athenians were the first in the history to use tokens in a scale unparalleled, if I paraphrase correct her words, in a scale unparalleled up to that time. I find that there are various responses to these questions, because it's about defining identity, and this is defining citizen identity for the Athenians. Then it has to do with the democratic procedures in order to safeguard the quality of speech. And I will explain, then in the next slides, I will explain more about that. Of course, they use tokens in the military. Perhaps the most direct testimony is Aristophanes, but we have also tangible evidence for that. Then, returning to a knowledge that is rooted to Mesopotamia, they were aware that they, with tokens, they could control public expenditure. They could minimize their outlay. They used tokens for logistics. Tokens were never money, but they played a supplementary role in the finance. And I aim to demonstrate to you how they did that. And then it is rationing, not just distributions, but rationing. When grain, for example, grain was not abundant available, tokens enabled the rationing. Another major question is the following thing, the phenomenon that tokens in Athens, in the 5th century BC Athens, tokens from public, how in ancient Athens, there is this transition from private to public, because the tokens of the ancient Mediterranean, the tessera hospitalis, were actually private agreements between two persons, a guest and its host, just what Theseus tells Media, the tokens of his host. But how did the Athenians came to this idea to take this knowledge or this technology, I would say, and apply this technology to their public domain? There are also split symbola, but there is also another big category, huge category of tokens, that there are non-split symbola. First, the split tokens. The split tokens of the mid 5th century BC in Athens. The three pieces on your left, and the one, there are just three pieces, but they are photographed from both sides, and then the one on your right. These were tokens split, cut in two, after they were fired, it's fired clay. So sorry for not showing you a color picture. This is black and white. This is black and white. And on one side, we have the tribe. It's the inscription, it's in the name of a tribe it is inscribed. It is inscribed on the middle of the surface, and across the name of the tribe, the token is cut in two. Then the token was turned on the other side, and all this before firing, with the technique of the black figured vases. What we have? We have an inscription. On the upper part, it is the name of the dean, and on the lower part, we have the name of the magistracy, which would be allotted. This is a mechanism, this is a technology for allotting magistracies, especially when we have magistracies in boards of 10. Possibly this is the poletai. These tokens were first excavated by Homer Thompson in the 50s and published by label in 1959. What lay in obscurity and was rediscovered by me was the Xipeteon token. It was in the deposits of the the National Archaeological Museum, and this was found in a well. All these, the first three tokens were found in a rubbish pit, because all tokens that we have are, this is very intriguing, I find, the tokens that we have are objects that have not finished their life cycle. They were either deposited on purpose and in a way, in a destructive way, so as not to fall in the false hands, or for some other reason, they did not arrive where they should arrive, and so they got rid of them, either in a rubbish pit, or this token from the National Archaeological Museum, it was found in a well, it was thrown in a well. Imagine how things work. It is the split tokens, and when the tokens were reunited, then the officers who conducted this allotment procedure knew that that the offices would be allotted to these deans, because this is a case where we have politai, the first token upper left, it writes the first three letters of the magistracy of politai. So we know that, and so when it was put again together, they drew the 10 pieces, and the 10 pieces were matched with 10 other halves that showed the correct name of the dean. The Xipeteon token is pierced, possibly because it was worn around the neck by the successful candidate as a sign of identification when he went over to assume duty. Sitting by letter, according to Philochorus, an ethnograph of the fourth century BC, sitting by letter, first began in the year 409 BCE. This is a troubled year. This is the first year after the restoration of the democracy. And it permits a series of reasoning that probably the sitting by letter was to avoid or to prohibit common thinkers to sit together in the council and then to influence the whole procedure or to shout down the orator. So so according to Philochorus, the council first began to sit by letter in this year, and still to his day, they continue to take an oath from the seat where they were allotted to sit. But we don't have any tokens of the council, or at least no tokens of the council have been identified. But we have letter tokens of the jurors' courts. When did these tokens begin? When may these tokens the earliest appearance? I think that the earliest sitting by letter for the jurors' courts should be dated in the late 5th century BC. There are some indication for that. This is the strata of the excavations in the ancient Agora. Then we have a series that it's marked with the crescent, and this relates well with the Athenian coinage of the 5th century BC. And then another indication is the flans. I haven't brought with me the right images to show to you, but we have hammered flans, and these are probably bronze coins recycled coming from South Italy. And they were recycled and used as tokens. And these tokens, the letter tokens, this is an example of a letter token, and also this one, another example of a letter token, were only in the hands of the citizens. Only the citizens were entitled to use tokens. And there is the narration of the in the text of the Athenaeum Politeia, I think it's 65, it's chapter 65 and chapter 68, it states clearly that the jurors entering the court, they were distributed tokens, public tokens. They took public tokens in their hands. And the text does not say clearly for what reason. But comparing evidence with the letter tokens known for the council, these were obviously also letter tokens for the jurors' courts. And there comes a special moment where tokens were also used for the remuneration for public office. Here is such an example of a token, remuneration for public office, again only for the citizens. Athens in the 5th century BC is in the procedure, is in a continuous procedure of defining citizenship, and very, very conscious about that. And all the prerequisites of using tokens, in my opinion, were created with Pericles' citizenship law of 451. We will come further also to that point. Split tokens as a sign of identification in military context are known from 4th century BC Athens. This is a good example. These are clay tokens that were found in a well. The two pieces were found in the well and they were reunited by the restorators. And they have inscribed the name of Xenocleas, of the Perithoide, of the deme of Perithoidae, and he was a peripolarchos. Peripolarchos is a special officer who is entrusted with overseeing the garrisons of the borders. And this brings us immediately to mind Aristophanes' passage and the birds, how Iris sneaks through the defenses and the guards ask her about the symbol. Was a symbol placed on your own token? These tokens found in a well in the Athenian Agora were obviously never used. Athenian Agora has luckily brought to light many material related to the cavalry archive, for example. There is a lot of material related to the military. And this is another piece of evidence, these two split tokens. Very recently, and we are very grateful to Dr. Makripodi for bringing to the scholarly attention this very valuable lot of approximately 100 clay lettered tokens. Never before was an assemblage of so many clay lettered tokens known to us. These were found very near the Pnyx and were brought to the Numismatic Museum. Here, the letters are not single letters, just like the letters on the jurors' tokens, but we have also double letters. The letter upper, it's in simple lines, in single lines. And then there are also other tokens with double letters. This means that they were used for a much larger body than the panels of the jurors. Perhaps you have a question in the back of your mind: how come I came to you and I have stated you with full certainty that these are the jurors' tokens? Because beneath what is the jurors' courts in the Athenian Agora, there was a whole hoard of utensilia relating to the courts. I mean that there were psifoi, steam marking, we say in German. They were, there was a lot of equipment. And among these equipments, we had also these letter tokens. So this is certainly letter tokens for the jurors. And then we have these clay tokens. These clay tokens, the letters here are not just 24, but with the addition of the sum P, we have 25 letters. And because there are 25 letters plus 25 because of the double lines, we have a series of 50 pieces. And these are a very good divide for the 6,000, the assembly, or the quorum of the assembly, the quorum of the Athenian assembly. We didn't know about that. The literary sources said about the syllogies of the deans who were responsible for receiving the citizens on the entrance. Receiving on the, for what purpose? To identify that these were citizens with full political rights and to distribute them tokens. The reason is to distribute tokens to these citizens. They had lists like the grammatia in their hands, comparing the lists. When the first 6,000 arrived, Here I quote the assembly women, Aristophanes' assembly women. In Aristophanes' assembly women says clearly, hurry up women, we must be early at the assembly. Otherwise we will not be early enough to have our tokens. And we will lose also our remuneration, the daily remuneration. So a whole world now opens up after this fine. And it's it's very logical to think, it's only plausible to think that the Athenians, the first six Athenians who arrived, enabled the beginning of the whole procedure for the assembly, then the discussion would begin. Only the first 6,000 got at the end of the day the pay for having attended the assembly. And this was important at the time of as the fourth century BC, a time we know that this is a time of inflation and of various problems in the Athenian public finances. And so they knew that we have so much money to spend for so many people coming and not more money. We will give this sum to the first 6,000 coming and then that's it. We got it. Imagine that this is, I think it is the text of the Athenian Politia, it says that the cost of the assembly was the biggest item of the budget, the biggest item of the budget for the Athenian state. And imagine that we have approximately 40 sittings of the assembly per year. The tokens, these tokens cannot be recycled. They were carefully collected back and reused, these clay tokens. They are not just, they're not like the lead tokens. Obviously, it comes a time when the two categories of tokens, the tokens for allotting to sitting areas and the tokens for pay were, these two procedures were served with the same token. And in my opinion, these are the specimens that prove that. Jack Kroll, in my upcoming volume, in my edited volume, writes extensively on that. These are on the lower right of the slide that I'm showing you. It is this example. We have letters on one side, but on the first side, we have the triobol type. It is the owl framed by two olive sprays, and triobolon is the pay for the jurors for the entire fourth century BC. For the entire fourth century BC, the juros pay is stable, didn't change. And they got a triobol stamp. It is only logical to think that because there are abundant examples of lead tokens stamped with a design that looks very much like the coins of the contemporary silver triobols, that these were pay tokens. Pay tokens and at the same time tokens for sitting. So entering in the place where they would sit and discuss, allotted to their seats, and these tokens exchange with the pay at the end of the day. Pay attention also, just one more moment on this slide, to pay attention on the state iconography. These are obviously tokens used by the Athenian state for state uses. So what do we have as iconography? The owl. We have Athena head, and there are also small symbols, the owl between the two of the letter lambda, the two rays, and something from the Eleusinian iconography, because the Eleusinian iconography is state iconography for the Athenians, a Bacchus ring. And here again, it could be also a Kermos or an urn for some public use. I think that they're a little bit dull, these impressions, they are dark, but there is a big portion of the tokens excavated in the Athenian Agora that bear iconography related with grain. A wheat of grain combined with various designs or a wheat of grain alone. There is a valuable inscription from Eleusis. That's it is a decree honoring a deon. He had been also previously, the text says, secretary to the treasurer of the granaries, and the soldiers stationed at Eleusis honor them for having distributed the ecclesiastica. Ecclesiastica is the name of the tokens. Because tokens were so widely used in the assembly that pars pro toto came to designate the whole category of the objects. The assembly tokens, the ecclesiastica tokens, ecclesia is the name of the Athenian assembly, the ecclesiastica tokens was obviously the everyday word used for tokens. But why use tokens for distribution? Because grain was not abundant. Even the greatest gift of grain recorded in the Athenian history, it is the grain by the grain gift by Demetrios Poliorcetes in 307. It is the huge amount of 150,000 medimnoi. This would bring 7 million to 200,000 rations of grain. And this was a grain gift, 307 BC, for the entire population, for the entire Athenian population by a Hellenistic king. But it was only enough to feed the entire Athenian population for a month. It was a little. There are inscriptions from the rest of the Greek world that instruct us on how the states and the cities coped with such grain gifts. For example, from Samos, we have a decree from the year 260 BC. There is a big gift of grain, and what do? They distribute only 4 or 5 portions of grain to each citizen per month, not daily. So that is the point of having tokens for grain distribution. It is all about rationing that probably began in the military, and then the idea was extended to the rest of the Athenian population. And then the pen tokens. Svoronos, in his seminal publication in Journal International de Hellenistic Numismatique in the year 1900, has a whole list, it covers a page of tokens described with the letters P, epsilon, ni, pen. And Svoronos lists approximately 20 different designs, all of them with the same inscription, pen. And Svoronos thinks that this is the Council of the 500. It is impossible because the Council of the 500 is never named as Pentakosi in the text. Is named as Hebuli and not the Council of 500. So a much more plausible interpretation that I have given is that it is the Pentadrachmia. Pentadrachmia is, from the literary sources, the amount given out for the theorica. And the state, obviously, instead of paying out in cash, they distributed tokens that enabled the citizens to attend festivals or to attend theater performances. Athenian state throughout its history tried to economize in terms of how much money was issued, how much money was struck. And I think this is a way of reducing, of minimizing the outlay. Instead of giving out money for theater performances, there is at least a point in history where they use tokens. I'm not saying that, I would like to be very cautious here, and I'm not saying that all theorica were distributed through tokens, but some of the theorica were, at some point in the history of Athens, were distributed through tokens, because on the other hand, I have a whole series of literary sources that say pretty clearly that these were done with money. The distributions of theorica were done with money. And then this is a big puzzle that hasn't been discussed adequately. It is a lot of 10 tokens. The number 10 is a letter token, irrelevant. But the other 9, they are tokens who have on them not numeric values, but monetary values. And they were found, all of them were found together in the same well in Keramaikos. They have monetary values on them, and the monetary values are very precise. I mean, that they have exact amounts of them to be exchanged not universally, because this is a basic difference with money. Money are exchanged universally. The transactions are countless. Money can be exchanged in countless transactions, nonstop. But tokens are only in transactions, in one-off transactions. And this is the case here. We have a one-off transaction, but it's so interesting that they have on them monetary values. And I give a list here, the key to decipher what is the number 6 and 7, is 3.5 and 1/4 of an obol. Number one is the greatest value of all. It's 4 drachmas and 3 obols. And each one of them has a different design. Each one of the tokens you see has a different device on it. They have been identified as ants, insects. Again, how abundant the material is. The material is really so abundant, the material excavated in the Athenian agora. And the question, are they public or are they private? But I would say that more than half of the tokens are silent. They bear no inscription on them. And the design they carry is puzzling, because it is a code. It is a code only for the ones that knew what it's all about, that who would participate on the occasion. And here it's a small sample, the god Eros, a griffin, a club, an ox, a trident, a helmet, every possible. But tokens worked so well in the Athenian society that already before the middle of the 4th century BC, we have tokens used by the tribes, either for occasions in the tribe itself, or for occasions that involved the whole of the 10 tribes. And here, this is a case where I managed to reconstruct a whole series of tokens. They are of the same fabric. They have these edges, that they are the knicked edges. They are thick flans. They have an incuse. And we have in each case only the 3 letters of the name of the tribe, and they belong to the same series, obviously for an occasion that involved all 3 tribes. Kek for Kekropis, Leo for Leontis, and Ip with the 2P for Hippothontis. More examples, a random selection. I give you here a random selection of other tribes. Tribe Eantis with a Hydria. Here, tribe and this, the tribal hero Leos, he's inscribed, and Erech. Here beside the tripod, we find the inscription Erech. It's for the tribe Erechthes with the god Dionysos. If I start telling you on what occasion these tokens would be, would all be pure conjecture. State iconography is omnipresent on tokens, but not only. A few examples of state iconography on tokens, it is the cicada. The cicada, obviously, at the time, it was thought just like a simple specimen of banal nationalism, just like other symbols of the modern states here nowadays. But originally, the cicada is the symbol par excellence of the Athenian citizen. It's the earthborn citizen. And we have so many cicadas. Here on the backside of this lead token, we have a cicada. You just see the wings. But this token is heavily countermarked with incused dots. Incused dots on the obverse, the owl, the tribal type, the owl with the spray, the owl with the spray. And the other side, the cicada. A token excavated in the council house in Athens and a countermark with incused dots, obviously after it had served its purpose. Attendance and was ratified with incused dots, probably. A gorgonion, another token with a public use. Remember that gorgonia are the stamps on the tokens, but on the bronze allotment plates for the allotment of the magistrates, the big plates with the names of the magistrates of the 4th century BC, these ones. but we are lucky enough to have tokens that they state on them that I am public, I am a demotion token. So here I had a title, Demotia tokens, Demotia symbola, because I give you here a random collection of tokens inscribed with delta eta, delta eta, Demotion. Why the Athenians, did the Athenians use tokens? It's also the Athenian way of life, that the Athenians were so extrovert. And they did not only participate actively in the governance of the city, they were active members of their tribe, they were active members of their deans, but the cult associations. And here a token inscribed Dex, the three first letter of Dex. And Dexion is a hero who had a cult place together with Asclepius. Obviously, here is the Orgeones, the cult association of the hero Dexion and their token. And imagine that of this cult association, we only possess two inscriptions and they are completely unknown. And now this is the third testimony for the cult association of around the hero Dexion. I presume that there are many more symbols of cult associations waiting to be discovered in the Agora. Here, another token. It bears an inscription. It's the goddess Artemis. Another one with Asclepius. You know, the diameters are really small, and it's not always easy to take good pictures of it. A case that has to do also with a cult association, or better, with banquets of cult associations, are the symbola agorastica. Agorastikon is a fee, actually. It's a fund. Then we have two inscriptions that say that that members of the same cult association came together, they contributed money, and they organized a symposium. And I think that tokens inscribed with the first four letters agor must be associated with tokens agorastika. And so I revised the old interpretation that they have to do with agoranomoi, the interpretation given by Svoronos. There are many tokens, besides that, there are so many tokens in Athens that have drinking cups on them and no other inscription, tokens with just drinking cups on them. Then all comes to an end with the Sullan destruction of the city. And the map I show you is, of course, the excavation grid of the Athenian Agora. And the big dots show the greatest concentration of finds. And where is it? It is in the bottom of the Great Drain. There are two pockets at the bottom of the Great Grain Drain that has delivered to us abundant number of tokens. And the second big concentration of token finds in the Athenian Agora. Here I discuss only the lead. In this plan, it's only the lead. It's here, the civic offices, this part of the stoa, the civic offices, and the council house. The council house and the seat of the Britannies, the executing committee of the Britannies. No coincidence. Where the seat of the government is, are the tokens. The tokens have to do with government, are the instrument of the government. And then the Sullan debris, but careful examination of the material of the Sullan debris is also brings thankfully a lot of good results. More on my project and of Professor Claire Rowan's project, you can see on the website of the University of Warwick. Here nests also an online exhibition dedicated solely to Athens. We have also our own database. There are many tokens there of the Athenian Agora uploaded. My special thank you. And also very much thank you to you for your attention and for your patience.